وَإِذْ نَتَقْنَا الْجَبَلَ فَوْقَهُمْ. And mention when we raise the mountain above them. Above who? Above the Bani Israel. When Musa a.s. brought the book to Bani Israel, they had difficulty accepting it. So what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised the mountain above them. نَتَقْنَا is from the root letters نُون تَا قَاف. And in taq, it means الزَّعْزَعْ وَالْهَزْ وَالْجَذْبْ وَالنَّقْصْ. It is to shake, to move something violently, and to pull it and shake it again in such a way that it becomes loose. It becomes loose. And when it becomes loose, if you just yank it out even once, it's going to come out very easily. Isn't it? Like, for example, if there is a nail that is in the wall and you want to pull it out, what are you going to do? Just pull with your two fingers? This is going to come out? No. What do you have to do? You have to loosen it. How? By shaking it. By moving it. And when you continue to move it, then eventually it's going to become loose and you pull it out once and it's going to come out very easily. Similarly, a weed or a plant that is in the ground, how do you pull it out? By shaking it. By moving it. So that it becomes loose. Once it becomes loose, then it's easy to take it out. So this is what natq means. To shake something, to move it, to pull it, so that it becomes loose. And then it is easy to lift it. So is nataqna al-jabala, when we shook it, when we made it loose, and natq is also to lift something and suspend it as a canopy, as a ceiling. So when we wrenched out, when we pulled out, when we took out the jabal and we suspended it, when we unearthed it from its roots and we suspended it فوقهم above them, كَأَنَّهُ as if it was ظُلَّةٌ a canopy. ظُلَّة is from the root letters la lam lam. And ظُلَّة is a canopy and it's also used for a cloud. It's from the word ظِل. What does ظِل mean? ظِل, shade, shadow. So, ظُلَّة, a canopy, because it gives shade. So the mountain was unearthed, it was wrenched out of the ground, and it was suspended on top of them, and it was on top of them just like a cloud is. Now you might wonder, how is that possible? It is possible. Because who is doing this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may wonder, but the mountain is so heavy. How can it stay up there in the sky? But if you look around you, there's so much snow. Isn't that heavy? It's extremely heavy. Where does it fall down from? From the sky. Where is it? In the clouds. Where are they? Up in the sky. Isn't there gravity? Of course there is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it happen. So He can also make a mountain be suspended in the air. Above them. So He put it above them. كَأَنَّهُ ظُلَّ as if it was a canopy, like a cloud. وَظَنُّوا and they thought. أَنَّهُ that indeed it, meaning indeed the mountain, was وَاقِعٌ بِهِمْ. It was going to fall upon them because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's threat to them. That it would fall upon them if they refused to accept the rulings contained in the Torah. So they were told, خُذُوا مَا آتَيْنَاكُمْ. Take whatever we are giving you. بِقُوَّةٍ with full strength. With determination. Take it seriously and earnestly. وَذْكُرُوا مَا فِيهِ and remember everything that is in it. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ so that you can develop taqwa. Because if you don't hold on to the book with quwwa, and if you don't remember all that is in it, you will not develop taqwa. And if you don't develop taqwa, then how will you obtain guidance? And if you don't obtain guidance, how will you get to Jannah? So the key to Jannah is holding on to the book with quwwa. If you notice, this has come so many times. Holding on to the book with quwwa. You may wonder, why is this being mentioned again and again? The fact is, we need this reminder again and again. Because we lose this quwwa when it comes to holding on to the Qur'an. When it comes to being determined with the Qur'an. We have a lot of determination, a lot of strength when we want to cook something that we like. When we want to set up our house the way we like it. When we want to look for a particular pair of shoes or a pair of clothes that we really like, we will have a lot of quwwa. We will go every day. We will spend hours. We will walk a lot. We will not get tired. Even if we get tired, we will put two extra strength Tylenols in our mouth. But when it comes to holding on to the Qur'an, when it comes to memorizing the lesson, when it comes to revising for the test, when it comes to doing the assignment, sometimes we lose all the quwwah that we have. There is no quwwah. We don't have it. But what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying? That hold on to the book with quwwah. And look what happened with the Bani Israel. The mountain was placed on top of them. Take it or else you're done. Or else you're finished. Take it with quwwah. And remember all that is in it. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ So what do we learn from this ayah? First of all, we learn from this ayah about the permissibility of using strictness and sometimes harsh measures to teach certain students. Because sometimes, some people, they don't listen. And for their goodness, what do you have to do? You have to be extremely strict with them. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was extremely strict with the Bani Israel. Take it, learn it, do your lesson. Otherwise, there are going to be consequences. So if a teacher uses harsh measures, why? To benefit the student, it is allowed. Okay? It is permissible. Just like if your child is not doing the homework, what do you say? You're grounded. You're not going anywhere until you finish the homework. If a child does not pass his test, what do the parents do? There is some kind of consequence. Isn't it so? You have to use some kind of harsh measure sometimes, otherwise some people don't listen. Secondly, we also learn from this ayah about the obligation of holding on to the book with quwwah. So we need to check ourselves. What is the strength of the translation that we are memorizing? What is the strength? Is it just on the passing mark? Does I make it to 18? I make it to 17? I make it to 20? Is that quwwah? Is that quwwah? You tell me. No. That's not quwwah. What is quwwah? An A. More than 95%. We know that 80% is passing marks for you. That's not quwwah. That's just getting by. Quwwah is when you know it 100%. When you know it very well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us, khudu, take it with quwwah. Just getting by is not acceptable. You have to do your best. And you have to keep trying. You have to keep trying. So we need to check the strength of our translation. The strength of the meanings of the Qur'an. The strength of the singulars and the plurals. The strength of the root words. The strength of everything related to the book. How strong is my grasp? How strong is what I have memorized? What I have understood? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us. Take it with quwwah. Then thirdly, we also learned from this ayah about the obligation of remembering and learning all of the Qur'an. Have we skipped a lesson or two? An ayah or two? A juz or two? What does Allah say? وَذْكُرُوا مَا فِيهِ All that is in it, that is necessary. Because if we leave out even one word, even one ayah, even one juz, that is not all of it. وَذْكُرُوا مَا فِيهِ All of the book. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ So that you can develop taqwa. And this also shows to us about the importance of reading or understanding the whole Qur'an. Because many times our focus is on only learning the 30 juz, only reciting Surah Yasin, only reciting Surah Al-Baqarah. Yes, they're very important. But at the same time, the whole Qur'an must also be given importance because Allah says, وَذْكُرُوا مَا فِيهِ What does مَا فِيهِ mean? All that is in it. Take all of it. Don't choose parts of it. وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ And mention, when your Lord took from the children of Adam, from their loins, ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ Their descendants. وَإِذْ Meaning, وَذْكُرْ إِذْ Recall the time when such and such happened. When did this happen? Basically, in this ayah, the ahd of alast is mentioned. What is it? Inshallah we will learn about it. But over here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ So when did this happen? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the covenant of Alast at An-Na'man. What is An-Na'man? It's a valley that is outside of Mecca. When? On the day of Arafah. What day was it? Arafah. How? That he extracted from the loins of Adam alayhi salam every single soul that would be created. Every single soul that would be created. Meaning every single human being. Because it's of the descendants of who? Adam alayhi salam. So why this human being is to live for a few moments, a few days, or many days, or many years. Every single soul to be created was brought out from the loins of Adam alayhi salam. And he spread them before himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spread all people, their souls where? Before himself. And he spoke to them face to face. And he said, "Am I not your Lord? Alastu bi rabbikum? Alastu bi rabbikum? Am I not your Lord?" And what was their response? قَالُوا بَلَى. They said, "Yes, of course you are." And this is reported in Musnad Ahmad. But remember that this is a statement of who? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. But as a general rule, also remember this fact, that any time a companion, a sahabi, of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he talks about the matters of the unseen, or the matters of creation, or the matters of ghaib, then it holds the same level as that of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because it cannot be imagined that they would say something like this without any evidence. It cannot be imagined that the Sahaba would say anything like this without any evidence. So when it comes to Aqidah, we give it the same importance as that of the statement of the Prophet ﷺ. But when it comes to matters of fiqh, then it remains their opinion and it does not take the status of hadith. So if you look at it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the covenant when? On the day of Arafah. And at what place? The valley of Na'man, which is outside of Makkah. So وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ, when your Lord took, مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ, from the children of Adam, when he took out, from the children of Adam, مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ, from their loins. The word ظُهُور is a plural of ظَهْر. And the word ظَهْر is actually used for the back, for the spine. What is it? The back or the spine. And it gives a sense of loins in Arabic. So basically, مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ, meaning he created the progeny of Adam alayhi salam, generation after generation, and each generation being produced from the loins of their predecessors. So who was taken out? ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ, their offspring. Meaning men, women, each generation was produced. Every single human being, you and I, all of us. وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ, and he made them testify. أَشْهَدَ, from the root letters, شِين هَا دَال, شَهَادَ. What does شَهَادَ mean? شُهُود, to bear witness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the people bear witness عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ, upon themselves. He took شَهَادَ from them, about themselves. Upon themselves, against themselves, so that they cannot offer any excuse on the day of judgment that we had no idea. What was the shahada that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made everybody take? That alastu bi rabbikum, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala questioned all people, am I not your Lord? Am I not your Lord? Qalu, they said, meaning all of the Bani Adam, they replied, bala, yes, of course you are, anta rabbuna. So why was the shahada taken against the people? Or how is it against the people? أَمْ تَقُولُوا, lest you all say, يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, on the day of judgment, إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَافِلِينَ, we were unaware of this. That we had no idea we had a Lord, that there was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whom we were supposed to worship, whom we were required to worship, we had no idea. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before sending people to the earth, what did He do? All of the souls were gathered in one place. They were produced. And they were all made to testify that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is their Lord. And this shahada was taken. So that no one can say later that I had no idea. If you notice the word, ashhadtum, shahada. Remember that shahada is of two types. One is qawli. What does that mean? That when a person bears witness through words. And the second is hali. That the state of a person bears witness. An example of qawli is, a person says, I am hungry. His words testify that he is hungry. Isn't it? Shahada Hali is, for example, a person looks extremely tired. He doesn't say he's hungry, but he looks extremely tired. He doesn't seem to have any energy. His face is going pale. Now his state testifies that he is hungry. Isn't it so? Over here, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the covenant, this shahada is qawli. Remember that. This is as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described it. Because there are some people who say, no, people didn't actually say it. It's not possible. It is possible. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَأَشْهَدُهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. What happened? قَالُوا. Look at the word قَالُوا. What does it mean? People said it. So this is shahada that is qawli. So what do we learn from this ayah? That every person who comes into this dunya is born upon the fitrah. What is fitrah? The innate disposition, the innate nature, which is that people in their nature, with their nature, they want to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is within the nature of every single human being. Search for God. Search for one supreme being. This is in the nature of human beings. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنِّي خَلَقْتُ عِبَادِي حُنَفَاءَ. I have created my servants hunafa, meaning monotheists. فَجَاءَتْهُمُ الشَّيَاطِينُ. But the devils came to them, and then they deviated them from their religion, prohibiting what I allowed for them. So every person was created on what? On fitrah. But later on, shayateen, they came and they deviated the people. From another hadith, we learn that every child is born upon the fitrah. It is only his parents who turn him into a Jew, a Christian, or a Zoroastrian, a fire worshipper. Just as animals are born having full bodies, do you see any of them having a cut-off nose when they're born? So people would later cut off their noses or their ears or something like that. But naturally, animals are born with their full bodies. So just as people are born on their fitrah. And fitrah necessitates the acknowledgement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the love of Allah is placed in the heart of every person. The acknowledgement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's existence, of His Lordship, is placed in the heart of every person. And many times people deny this. That no, people are born with an empty slate and they have nothing. Especially people who are in sociology, in psychology. Some say that there is a nature from before and they say, no, there is no nature. And people, as they grow older, then they learn. And if you were to leave a child on his own, he would not know what to do. He would not know how to use the washroom. He would not know how to eat, what to eat. And they present cases such as a child was left in the forest with wolves or other animals and he grew up to be just like them. Allahu A'lam. I'm sure the wolves devoured such a child. Allahu A'lam. But what do we learn? That every child in his heart, he has this acknowledgement of the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what every person is born with. And later on, this nature is wiped off or it is altered because of what the person is exposed to. And if you look at it, for example, look at the example of those countries where religion was completely banned. For example, look at Turkey. Publishing the Quran was not allowed. There was a ban on hijab. Studying the Quran, reading the Quran, all of this was not permissible. But when that era was over, the people went back themselves. Similarly in Russia, religion was not allowed at all, complete ban. But as soon as that was over, people went back to their religion. Why? Because it is within the nature of people. So many stories of converts you will hear that I was in search for peace, I was in search for one true God, one supreme power, and that is how I found Islam. So this is within the nature of every person. But now, over here you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَنْتُقُولُوا, lest you say on the day of judgment that we were unaware of this. How many of you remember this covenant? How many of you remember this covenant? So then how come Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that you cannot present this as an excuse on the day of judgment that we did not know? Do you remember the day you were born? Do you? No. Do you remember how your mother first held you? How she treated you when you were young? How your father cared for you, which people looked after you in your first few years, how they played with you. No, you don't remember anything. But has that not affected you? It has affected you. the way a child is treated in his first years, initial years, the way he is treated, the way people play with him, the way people deal with him, that is how he develops. If he is shown love, he will become loving. If he is ignored, he will become very rebellious. If his needs are not catered to, he will grow up to be extremely unhappy. So there are some events, many events that happen in our lives, but we don't remember them at all. But they definitely affect us. They definitely affect us. And they are in our minds, where? In the subconscious. Because of which they continue to affect us. And many times what happens? You don't remember all of those events, but who tells you? Your parents. Sometimes they will show you a picture. You see, there was this child, this was our neighbor, and you used to play with her every day. You used to love playing with her. This toy you used to love. And when you hear these stories, you believe in them. Why? Because your parents are telling them. And they have affected you. So similarly, this is a memory that we have forgotten. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent messengers to remind us. He sent messengers to remind us. And just as we trust our parents, similarly we trust the messenger of Allah. And he is reminding us of this. Which is why when the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or every messenger, when he reminded the people of this covenant, when he reminded them about what they were supposed to do, many people, they responded positively. Because it made sense to them. They accepted it willingly. So it is in our subconscious and it affects us. And the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent messengers, why? In order to remind us about this, so that nobody can say on the Day of Judgment that, oh Allah, I had no idea. أَوْ تَقُولُ Or you might say, إِنَّمَا أَشْرَكَ آبَاؤُنَا مِنْ قَبْلُ That it was only our forefathers who did shirk before. Meaning before us, our forefathers, our parents, they used to do shirk. وَكُنَّا And we were ذُرِّيَّةً مِّن بَعْدِهِمْ We were children after them. And children, they learn everything from their parents. Whatever they did, we followed them in that. أَفَتُهْلِكُنَا Then would you destroy us بِمَا فَعْلَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ Because of what the falsifiers used to do. مُبْطِلُونَ is a plural of مُبْطِل. And who is مُبْطِل? أَهْلُ الْبَاطِل. Meaning one who is a follower of falsehood. So مُبْطِلُونَ, followers of falsehood. Why would you punish us for the wrong that the previous people did before us? So we see that no excuse will be accepted on the Day of Judgment. No excuse. People cannot present the excuse that I had no idea you created me. I had no idea that you sent me in this dunya for a purpose. I had no idea because my parents, they taught me the wrong ways and I just followed them. So there is no fault of mine in this. No. No excuse will be accepted on the Day of Judgment because every person is born in fitrah. Every person has this alarm or has this voice in his heart, search for God, search for God. There is someone out there whom you must worship. There is someone behind all of the sun and moon and everything that's going on. And this is within the nature of every single person. Some people, they suppress this voice. They completely kill it. And other people, they don't stop until they get the answers. They don't stop until they get the answers. And we see that even Prophet ﷺ, before he became a prophet, there were some people in Makkah who were called Hunafa. Who were they? Everybody was doing shirk. But there were these people, some individuals, who did not do shirk. And they only used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we learn about their stories, how they traveled or they went so many places. But they knew that shirk was wrong and there is only one God and they must only worship Him. So if there were some people who in the midst of darkness could respond to the call of their heart that there is one God, then what does it show? That other people should have done the same as well. They don't have any excuse. If there were some individuals who found the answers, then how come the rest of the people did not have the search for those answers? Of course they did. They just suppressed that call. They were indulged in their dunya because of which they didn't care about those answers. وَكَذَٰلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ And thus do we explain in detail the verses. وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ And perhaps they will return. These verses, they are made clear to us so that we can reflect on them and we can take heed and so that we can return from disobedience to obedience. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took a covenant from all of us and He sent us to this dunya so that we would worship Him. But there are some people who become lost. They walk on the path of shaitan. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains these ayat clearly so that people can return. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spread clear signs because it's al-ayat. And ayat is ayat shari as well as kauni. There are kauni ayat all around us so that people can return to their creator. They can return to their master. We listen to the recitation of these ayat.